Hello everyone, it is I, the Comics Kid 2099, here to examine another issue of the X-Men. Today, we will be examining X-Men issue 23, edited by Stan Lee, written by Roy Thomas, with pencils by Werner Roth. Werner Roth has actually been penciling the series for a little while, but this is the first time that he is using his real name in the credits. Up until now, he has been using the alias J. Gavin, and so I think that's kind of cool. I'm not really sure what changed before now. Back in the 1960s, there was a little bit of a stigma towards superhero comics. Artists, it was more prestigious to be working on a newspaper comic, such as Terry and the Pirates or Crash Corrigan or something like that. That was a better career opportunity for artists than working on just a superhero comic. And so it's possible that Werner Roth thought that working on the X-Men was beneath him, and he was going to use an alias here until he could get a better job working on some newspaper comic strip of some kind. And then it's possible that he thought, you know what, I'm in this too deep now, I might as well just keep working on the X-Men and just use my real name. I actually do not know why he decided to start using his real name in the credits here. I'm just speculating that he was a little bit ashamed to be working on this, and that's why he was using an alias. I can't imagine any other reason that you would do something like that other than a little bit of shame, but it's kind of cool that he's using his real name here, with inks by Dick Ayers and lettering by Artie Simek. This issue picks up where the previous issue left off. Count Nefaria and his ridiculous team of supervillains have kidnapped the X-Men, and Count Nefaria has promised that he is going to kidnap the capital of the United States of America, Washington, D.C. And the X-Men, they are either going to join him or they're not, but either way, they are going to be blamed for what he is doing. As we saw in the previous issue, somehow, Count Nefaria has illusion powers. I'm not sure if he is creating these illusions mechanically or if this is a superpower he has. That's never actually explained, but we saw these illusions a little bit in the previous issue, and here he uses them a little bit more to frame the X-Men for wanting $3 million or $3 million from Washington, D.C. And this issue, as I said last issue, that whole issue could have been summed up in about three pages. It didn't need to take an entire issue to show Count Nefaria and his people kidnapping the X-Men one at a time. They all could have been kidnapped, and they could have met Count Nefaria by page three, and then the events of this issue could have taken the rest of an issue. This did not need to be a two-part story. Basically, this one, Count Nefaria erects a giant dome over Washington, D.C., and the promise that we were given at the end of the previous issue and the beginning of this issue is not lived up to. This is something that you see a lot in comic books, where you'll see something crazy and weird at the end of the issue as a hook to try and get you back for the next issue, or you'll see something crazy and weird on the cover as a hook to get you to buy that issue. All those comic book covers from the 50s where Superman is being a jerk, you know, burning a bathrobe that Jimmy Olsen got him for Father's Day, stuff like that was really weird, and we make fun of it now, but that was a really good hook. Why is Superman being a jerk to Jimmy Olsen? I have to buy this and figure out why. At the end of the previous issue, Count Nefaria says, I am going to kidnap the entire capital of the United States of America. And then here he says it again at the beginning of the issue, that he's going to kidnap the entire capital. And then ultimately, he just ransoms them for $3 million. That is so much more mundane than actually physically kidnapping an entire city. That sounded weird and wacky, and I wanted to see how this series would pull it off. And ultimately, they don't pull it off. He just ransoms them for some money. That is probably the most boring thing that could have happened, especially with the promise that was given that he was going to kidnap an entire city. So that was a little disappointing. Then for about 10 pages of this issue, the X-Men are basically playing keep away with this bag of money. They tell Count Nefaria that they will join forces with him because Professor Xavier, he hears on the radio that the X-Men are involved with this scheme to blackmail the city. So he contacts them to figure out what's going on, and then he tells them, go ahead and pretend like you're working with Count Nefaria. I've got a plan. And so for about 10 pages, the X-Men are trying to keep this money from going back to the people of the city who attacked them by throwing bricks at them. And then Count Nefaria's supervillains actually decide that they are going to betray Count Nefaria, and then they will steal the money. So for about half of this issue, all it is the X-Men trying to keep the money from falling into the wrong hands. And again, you could have condensed this issue and the previous issue into one issue. Over half of this comic is just a really long chase scene and not a very exciting chase scene, especially when my interest in this comic has already been deflated because Count Nefaria is not doing what he said he was going to do. Also, while Professor Xavier is working on some kind of invention, he's thinking to himself about how it's a good thing I turned off my telepathy. The X-Men couldn't contact me even if they wanted to, which seems really reckless because, yes, you think that they're on vacation, but what if something happens to them? These are the X-Men we're talking about. The last time they went on vacation, they ran into some trouble, so maybe don't turn off your telepathy whenever they're on vacation. Because he finds out from this four-star general guy who is actually there on the sidelines when the X-Men fought the Sentinels, that guy calls Professor X and says, hey, since you're a human being that I can trust, I need you to come here and be a civilian advisor while the X-Men are holding Washington, D.C. captive. And then Professor X goes there. He says, well, I'm going to have to think on this a little bit. And then when the X-Men leave with the money, the general says, I don't need you here anymore. So, what was the point of even bringing Professor X there? While he's working on this thing, it's an invention that we find out later he's been working on for months. Then he goes to, the outskirts of Washington, D.C. As I understand it, he doesn't actually go inside because there's a giant dome over the city. But he goes on the outskirts, and then whenever he says, I'm going to need to think about this for a little bit, he astral projects so that he can see what's going on, and he sees that Count Nefaria is behind all of this. He's thinking to himself that astrally projecting is the closest thing that he's going to get to walking for the rest of his life. As we saw last issue, he was kind of woe is me a little bit that he's never going to be able to walk again. But then we find out at the end of the issue that this invention he's working on is actually some magnetic leg braces that allow him to walk for short periods of time anyway. And so he does get to walk in this issue. He actually puts on a big mask and just walks right into Count Nefaria's headquarters and I guess reads Count Nefaria's mind so that he can take down the dome and destroy the machine while the X-Men are trying to keep him from getting the money. And so Professor X is crucial in defeating the bad guy here. We haven't seen that in a little while. I do wish that the X-Men had been able to defeat this bad guy on their own. We saw the X-Men graduated from Professor Xavier's school back in like issue 10, I think. It would be nice to every once in a while get to see them do something on their own without Professor X having to come and hold their hands. I was a little crestfallen to see Professor Xavier contact them and say, hey, await further instructions, because technically the X-Men graduated. It would be nice to see them get to handle a situation on their own without him having to babysit them. Also, I think he uses these magnetic leg braces again next issue, if I'm not mistaken, and then after that, I'm pretty sure he never uses these again. It's really great to see that Professor Xavier has basically cured the use of the wheelchair. You no longer need a wheelchair at all. You can actually walk if you break your spine or break your legs, and then he just keeps this invention to himself and uses it like twice and then never again. At the very least, I don't know why he doesn't use it every issue, but whatever. So then this issue ends with Jean Grey getting a letter saying that she has been accepted into college and she's going to have to leave the X-Men forever. Oh, melodrama! Much like Professor Xavier inventing this machine, much like the X-Men graduating, this isn't actually going to go anywhere, as you probably guessed. Jean Grey is going to go to college, but she's somehow going to manage to stay with the X-Men forever. So, I guess slight spoilers for upcoming issues, but you probably knew that Jean Grey wasn't leaving the team. But that is another end of the issue hook to try and get you interested in the next issue. And then, much like this issue, disappointed us with Count Nefaria's evil plan. Next issue is going to disappoint us with Jean Grey not actually leaving the X-Men. But those are my thoughts on this issue. Like I said, this issue and issue 22 really could have been one issue. They're really stretching things thin here, and they're going to keep doing that for a while. But a little later, at least, it's going to feel more justified. But right now, it really feels like they want to have these multi-part storylines, but they're not really sure how to do it. They're still kind of trying to figure out the art of doing something longer than a standalone issue, and they just haven't quite grasped it yet. But this was a good little conclusion to that issue. We will never see any of these characters, except for Count Nefaria, in this series again anyway. But that's about all that happened in this issue. I hope that you guys liked my video, and if you read the issue, I hope that you enjoyed it. And next week, I'm going to try and examine another issue of the X-Men. Until then, I hope that you guys have a great rest of the day. See you then.